Away we go. Greetings, junior scientists, and citizens of the great, big, weird, wild, and wonderful world in which we live. As always, I'm your humble science communicator, the great Orbax, coming to you from the Department of Physics at the University of Guelph. I'd like to welcome you to our September 2023 Stargazing Guide. Well, here we are. September is finally upon us, and many of you will be returning back to your studies. We're a far way away from those late summer nights. By the end of September, sunrise will be taking place at 7 a.m., and sunset will be taking place as early as 7 p.m. But you know what that means? 12 hours of stargazing, junior scientists. This month, we look to the return of our gas giants. I show you a few new constellations to add to your list, and I explain the autumnal equinox. All this and more, we just take some time to look up. Well, I've got to ask you, what are we going to do about all these planets? Mercury will be at its greatest western elongation on the morning of September 22nd, seen due east, rising about 100 minutes before sunrise. Our gas giants, Saturn and Jupiter, return to our September sky, with Jupiter dominating the early hours of the morning and Saturn lighting up our evening. And speaking of Saturn, this month we're going to use our planet spotting skills to locate some lesser known constellations. Just after sunset, look to the southeast. That bright light in the sky, just a little bit above the horizon, but not too far up, that's Saturn. How do we know it's Saturn? Well, planets have a unique trait that makes spotting them distinct from finding a star. You see, the light that comes from planets in our solar system tends to be constant, whereas the light we see coming from stars tends to flicker. Locate that solid light, and we start from there. All right, so you've got Saturn. Now look up. This first one's gonna be tough. It's actually the second smallest constellation in the night sky, and it's called Aquilius, the little horse or foal. Aquilius is faint and may be difficult to see due to light pollution, but it's one of the original 48 constellations introduced by Ptolemy in the 2nd century. If we keep traveling upwards, you'll discover Delphinus, the dolphin. Delphinus is also a very small constellation, but the brightest stars outline a diamond-shaped asterism that you should be able to spot, known as Job's Coffin. Delphinus contains 5 stars with known planets, as well as some globular clusters and the Blue Flash Nebula. Okay, let's keep going for one last constellation that I want to tell you about. Pretty much directly above you at this point is Vulpecula, the little fox. It's also very faint, but lucky for you, it's smack dab in the middle of our well-known friend, the Summer Triangle. Vulpecula actually contains a Messier object, M27, the Dumbbell Nebula. So there we have it, starting at Saturn and going all the way up to the center of the night sky. A few new constellations for you to keep your eyes out for, junior scientists. Good luck and clear skies. The full moon this month is on September 29th. And since it's the closest one to the autumnal equinox, it's typically referred to as the harvest moon. Not only that, it's our 4th and final supermoon of 2023. What's a supermoon? Check out our stargazing guides from July and August to learn more. The Mi'kmaq refer to the September moon as the mating moon, Wigoongay-Wigoos, as do the Cree Nation of Central Canada, who refer to it as Namitahawepism, the rutting moon, when the bull moose scrapes the velvet from its antlers as a sign that mating season will begin. As I mentioned earlier, September 23rd is the first day of autumn, and here's why. We all remember that the Earth is tilted at 23.5 degrees with respect to the line that's perpendicular to the plane of our orbit around the sun. One Earth year corresponds to one full solar orbit. In December, we talked about the winter solstice. In June, we talked about the summer solstice. The solstice occurs on the day when we're either closest to or furthest away from the sun due to that tilt of the Earth. These are the days where we experience the most daylight hours or the least daylight hours, the two extremes. Exactly halfway between the solstices, we have a day where we experience equal amounts of daylight and nighttime hours. This is the equinox. The autumnal equinox occurs on September 23rd this year and denotes the first day of autumn. After this point, our daylight hours will decrease until we reach the winter solstice in January. This phenomenon occurs again in 6 months when we've completed 180 degrees in our rotation around the sun in the springtime for the vernal equinox. Our nights are getting longer, and with an early sunset, even more of you will get the opportunity to see the wonders of the universe that spiral above our heads, just beyond the edge of our skies. So many clouds that shield our view, even the sun itself, blocks our gaze with its light, but still we persevere. Still we seek out mysteries, and still we gaze upon an infinite view of possibilities. All this is out there, waiting for you. And all you have to do is just take some time to look up. See you next month, Junior Scientists, and don't forget to have a science-tastic day.
Special thanks to Royal City Science's own planetary geochemist, Dr. Glynis Perrin, for her help preparing our stargazing guide. And the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada.